Good morning and happy Sabbath, church. I said good morning and happy Sabbath. That's better. It's great to see everyone here today, and there's a lot of very new faces, so I'd like to welcome all our visitors here today, as well as our regular members and our church family as well that's joining us on Zoom. So a warm welcome to everyone here. Just to start our service today, just some announcements. Last week, I announced just our Pathfinder sign-up afternoon and swimming on a day for this. I think I've got to check my dates now. I'm not very organized today. the 6th of February, which is our Pathfinder sign-on afternoon, and the 7th of February, which is our swimming honor at the Mudribar pool. I've still yet to send out an email, so hopefully to all the Pathfinder parents, I'll be able to send this out this afternoon. And Tony has an announcement as well. I'd just like to welcome up Tony.
Thanks. All right, good morning, everyone. A couple of things real quick. First of all, welcome to those who are from far away. I know some were from my class, but I think we ought to welcome them because some are from Czechoslovakia. And so where are those from Czechoslovakia? They were there somewhere. There you go. God bless you. And someone was with you. Are they there still? They've gone outside? Was there something I said? God bless you. So glad to have you. We have some folk coming from the Sunshine Coast. Where's the Sunshine Coast folk? There you are. God bless you in the back. And we have some folk from Melbourne. And they don't have to cry unclean. They're all good. Is there anybody else visiting us from anywhere else around that we just need to recognize you? We do always want to. Yes, where are you from? Cairns. From Cairns. Lovely. What are your names? Such a lovely group. Yes? Okay. Wonderful. God bless you so much, coming all the way from Cairns. Is there anywhere from somebody from somewhere else? Yes. Victoria. You're not unclean either. God bless you. We have quite an audience there today. Anywhere else? From anybody from anywhere else? Just want to make sure we recognize those of our visitors. Even if you're from local, but you're visiting, I just want to greet you. Is there anybody local that's visiting? Okay, God bless you. We have a wonderful time. As you know, we are still unfortunately in the hands of a COVID crisis, but God is good. Now, a couple of things with regard to what's happening in the next few weeks. So we have services, as you know, continuing at 9:30 Sabbath school here in church. This week we have Brother Ettienne, who I'm really excited. I'm looking forward to your presentation. Brother Ettienne is from the Voice of the Martyrs. And what Brother Ettienne will do, what we'll do is as Brother Ettienne is speaking, if you want to join up, we'll send out a little sheet of paper. You just write your name. I'm really excited about the message that he's going to share. I've had some chance to speak with Brother Ettienne about persecution of God's people all around the world. It really surprised me. I did not know that. And it shows us that in Australia, we're in a bubble. Everybody realizes that, eh? We're in a little bubble here. This does not represent the real world. Real world of COVID, the real world of persecution, real world of hunger, the real world of trouble and disasters. This is a little bubble we're in. And it's good that we have someone like Brother Ettienne, who is very high up in that ministry, Voice of the Martyrs, to share with us. God bless you, Brother Ettienne. Our new pastor comes in on February the 6th, Pastor Andrew. And when he comes, we will be having the chance to introduce him, and he will be able to speak and take over ministry. Next week, I'll be here for the divine service as well. Title of the sermon is Run for Your Life. Run for Your Life. So by God's grace, we hope to be there. Now, there's somebody leaving us today, which is Brother Greg. Where is Brother Greg? I saw Brother Greg. Come up, Brother Greg, so that everybody could see you. I know he has joined us. He was with he came with Pastor. He was listening to Pastor's Revelation seminar, and then he sat some other studies. He's been with Myrtle's group, And you're going to Bundaberg.
That's correct, yes.
Well, God bless you. We're going to make sure you, just make sure you wash your hands, because I'm going to shake your hand.
Yeah, put it on.
But please make sure you put your sanitizer when you're finished to maintain our COVID safety.
Yeah, okay.
There is no COVID in Queens, unfortunately, but we're good. Brother Greg, we just want to leave a little card with you for you to remember
us.
I know when you go back, you'll be going to Bundaberg. Look, just find a nice church. There's a number of lovely churches in Bundaberg.
Yeah, there's two Adventist churches.
Two Adventist churches there. Please keep us involved. Take Myrtle's number and let us know how you're doing, and we'll be praying for you.
Yes, thank you very much.
Would you just say amen for my brother? God bless you. Can we all say amen?
Thank you.
So wonderful to have you with us, and wonderful. God bless you as we. I hope whenever you're visiting, please make it your visit. For us.
Thank you, Tim.
God bless you.
Yeah, bless everybody. I'd like to honor you all. Thank you very much.
God bless. Thank you very much. Okay, so God bless you. Thank you very much. And we'll just pass over and let us begin. As I say, bear with us. We are playing with some technology, and it's a little challenging to work through all of the technology conversions, but bear with us. And by God's grace, Brother Dan is on top of it. So we'll see how we go. Thanks for that.
Thank you, Dr. Tony. It's now come time for our invocation. And for those that are joining us here that are new, our invocation is just a time of just personal reflection and prayer before we start our main service. Thank you. I'd now like to invite everyone to stand as we sing our first song, Nearer My God to Thee.
So, sure, Joe, whenever you're going to just take off the mute for me, because my songs have to work with the mute.
So yeah. Every time. sorry. And we're going to sing another song as well, our second song being I Need Thee Every Hour, and we can remain seated. Thank you for singing, church family. It's now come time to seek a reverent position as we bow our heads in prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, we surrender all. Lord, every head bowed here, Lord, all of us have something to thank you for. Lord, we all thank you for our lives. We all thank you that we are safe here in this fortunate country. We are thankful, Lord, that we are free from persecution, that we can worship you freely. We are thankful, Lord, for the day and the Sabbath that we have to worship you, and that we have this day of rest to cease from our daily duties and focus on you and to grow closer to you. Thank you as well that we can come together to worship you collectively, that we could be here, Lord, to praise you together and to uplift our requests to you this time. Lord, I pray that you hear the prayers of the hearts of those who are bowed here today. Lord, each of us have different struggles. We all are dealing with different things. Lord, we need healing in our lives. We have loved ones that need Jesus in their lives. Lord, I pray that you pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and aid us in our requests and hear our petitions, Lord. Please help us with our financial difficulties, with health problems, with family problems, Lord, with addictions, Lord. We are all struggling with different things, and I pray that you be with us and cause us, Lord, to grow closer to you and to serve you more. I pray, Lord, as we continue through our service, that you be with us, be with those, Lord, as well, that are at home through Zoom, Lord, that you bless their families as well and bless them through this service. Please keep us safe through this new week, and please keep us following you more. I pray these things in your name. Amen. It's now come time for our offering, and the offering for today is an SPD offering that is going towards youth training and youth discipleship. So if we could invite the deacons to come down and we'll collect the offering. And we'll pray over the offering after it has been collected as well. Gracious Heavenly Father, thank you for the money that has been given through this offering. Lord, I pray as your son Jesus, Lord, had multiplied the bread and the fish, I pray that you multiply this money that it may be used to further the work of your kingdom. I pray blessing over the offering, Lord, in your name. Amen. It's time for our children's story. For those that are on, Zoom, bring your children around to the screen so that they may enjoy the story that will be played shortly.
If you really pray, God will answer your prayer.
Ivel is a 10-year-old boy who lives in Mongolia. When he was 5 years old, he moved from Mongolia to the Philippines. His father needed to study at a university in the Philippines. Ivel also needed to study, so his parents sent him to the first grade. School was very difficult for him. The teacher and all the other children spoke in English. Ivel understood very little English. After school, the boys teased him as he waited for his ride home. "You can't do anything," one boy said. "You can't even write," said another boy. "Go to kindergarten." When he heard these hurtful words, Ivel ran back into the school and hid behind the door of his classroom. He didn't want to cry in front of the other children. That night, when Ivel went to bed, he wanted to kneel and pray to God for help, but he was afraid that if his mother saw him praying, she would ask him what he was praying about. Ivel didn't want his mother to worry, so he woke up in the middle of the night when his parents were sound asleep and quietly prayed to God. "Please let me go to another school and make friends," he prayed. Ivel prayed nearly every night for several months. Then his parents suddenly decided to send him to a different school. The children at his new school were kind. They helped him learn to speak English. When he hurt his leg playing soccer, the other boys helped him walk home. Ivel was so happy that God had answered his prayer about going to a new school. Before he prayed about his school troubles, Ivel had never asked God for anything. He had even wondered whether God really exists. Ivel went to church every Sabbath, but he wondered how God could create the world with just his words. But ever since his prayers were answered, he believes that God is real. Ivel is now in the fifth grade, and he lives back in his home country of Mongolia. But he has never forgotten how God answered his prayers. Ivel has many friends in Mongolia, but many of them come from families who don't know about God. Please pray for the only Adventist school in Mongolia. Your mission offerings have helped this school grow and teach more and more students about God.
I'd now like to invite my wonderful girlfriend, Dawn Antonio, to come and share a special item with us.
For those who are in the Zoom audience, unfortunately, our technology is just upgrading now. So you will see the person singing. This person speaks, will be singing, but you will not hear the voice. So if you're on the Zoom platform, it's not a fault with your system. It's just right now, probably by the next week, we'll be able to do the live conversion. Right now, we can't. So bear with us just for the singing, but please enjoy it, the music as best you can. Thank you.
Well, good morning. It's lovely to be with you here this morning. We used to be members of this church back in the mid to late 90s for about 2 years. Some of you can still remember us, since we can still remember some of you. There's a lot of new faces, but also in the audience, there's some visitors from Melbourne that I know. Matter of fact, it was 52 weeks ago this day that I was preaching at KC Seventh-day Adventist Church, sharing a very similar presentation with Pastor Mohanu, Pastor Michael and his wife. And what a wonderful church it is. I was so encouraged by the worship there. We enjoyed it. It was a vibrant church service, lively in the Lord and in the Holy Spirit. So I'm looking forward to another invitation to come back and share again, Pastor, but good to see you in the audience as well. And it's a privilege for my wife and myself to be with you today and to come and share. We are going to visit you a little bit more often. As of November, we moved back to the Gold Coast. We always thought we'd have to come back and retire here, but I'm not retirement age yet. So we are here a little bit earlier, but I'm here to set up a base for the organization I work for called Voice of the Martyrs. I've been involved with Voice of the Martyrs now for about 3 years. I was working for 3ABN Australia Radio and doing a little bit of television with them prior to that, and got really fascinated by the subject of persecution. Now, at Seventh-day Adventist, you know, we study the prophecies. We know there's going to be persecution such as never was for an intense and short period of time just before Christ comes. And I got fascinated about that, so I decided that I would actually do a little bit more of a study, started reading Fox's Book of Martyrs. And during this period, a friend of mine contacted me who used to work with me in the corporate world in New Zealand. I hadn't seen him for 15 years. And he said, "You won't believe it, I've actually changed gears. I'm now working for a ministry called Voice of the Martyrs." I didn't know too much about Voice of the Martyrs at the time, although I had seen the name online when I've done some Googling to look at persecution information. And to cut a long story short, I started doing some programs on persecution called Souls Under the Altar. It's available online still. And then once a month, I would interview the CEO for Voice of the Martyrs on his trips as he brings back reports of what's happening around the world with Christians and Christian persecution. One thing led to another. We became very good friends. Next minute, I'm off to Korea with him, meeting some people from the underground church in Korea, people who've defected and have fled because of their faith and persecution to South Korea. Then we go to China and we meet some of the underground church in China, interview these people, and I'm so inspired by these people. They eat, breathe, and sleep the Word of God. They have a relationship with the Lord. Prayer life is vibrant and alive. They're constantly in prayer. And I was actually rebuked by their Christianity, because the promises in the Word of God, having to face persecution on a daily basis, not knowing whether you're going to get thrown into prison or end up in the labor camp or be executed, is real. So when they read the promises in the Word of God, I, by imagination, can enter into those promises, especially in the Psalms. But they live that experience. They claim those promises. And it's a totally different level of Christianity that I came across there. So today I want to share that a little bit with you. And I just want to make sure I can get my screen shared here properly. Right. I think everybody should see that now. Okay. Just as we start, I just invite you to bow your heads for a word of prayer as we ask God's blessing on what we share together now. Our gracious Father in heaven, you are our creator, our redeemer, and sustainer. You are from everlasting, and you know the end from the very beginning. You knew even this moment we would share together here this morning. You knew who would be here in attendance. You knew where our minds would be at. You know the week that we've had. But Father, as we come before you this morning, we just rededicate our lives to you. Whatever our experience has been of the past, not thinking but we will or won't do, but Father, just giving ourselves to you, so that you even give us the desire for positive, wholesome things, a connection with you, a relationship with you through your Holy Spirit. And Father, this morning we just pray for your Holy Spirit to be present, to strike an answering chord in every person's heart here this morning, that as I speak and I pray for a baptism of your Holy Spirit, that you would speak through me this morning as we share many stories of encouragement, of hope, sometimes stories that are very sad. But Father, we just pray that the blessing in it may be evident as we listen together, as we are encouraged together, and as you speak to us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Voice of the Martyrs has been around for a while. Now, why does an organization like us exist? A lot of people don't realize how prominent persecution is around the world. So I want to share just a few statistics with you this morning. Let me just see if I can get this. Here we go. Right. So what does our world look like at the moment? Christians are the most persecuted religion in the world. Pew Research brings that out very clearly. Then there's some other information from Christian Faith and Freedom, as an organization we work with based in Canberra. They're saying that 200 million Christians live where persecution is severe. You're pretty much guaranteed to be persecuted in those areas. Then there's another 400 million that live in areas where they are at risk. And a lot of these people do experience persecution. Some people can go under the radar. Some people are in underground churches to avoid being detected. But then there's also another source, Open Doors, that say that as of October last year, so that's a 12-month tracking, 340 million believers face persecution for their faith in Christ. The previous year was 260 million. There's been an increase of 60 million. That's 22% in the last 12 months. Matter of fact, 2020 has been the worst year for persecution in modern history. COVID-19 has been used by many groups, even governments at times, to add pressure, put pressure on Christians. For example, when there's aid being distributed, because under COVID you had to be in a lockdown, you can't work. Some of them are subsistence farmers, the Christians. They will say to you, all you have to do is to denounce your faith in Christ and we will give you this food parcel. Now, your children may not eat them for days. You may be hungry as well. So what do you do in those circumstances? Do you trust God has said that your bread and your water will be sure? Or do you just say, look, Lord, you'll have to understand, I'll have to compromise my faith in you or my love for you just so that I can feed my children? What would you do? There are some that compromise, but there are many that don't. And it's a tough decision to make, but these are decisions that we got to be ready to experience ourselves, because we see so many changes happening in our country. You're not only here in Australia, but other free countries, you know, Western countries around the world. And what we've seen happen in the last 5 years is probably what you would see normally in a generation or two, as far as changes are concerned. If you've been tracking what's been happening in regards to attitudes towards Christians, the Christian worldview, Christian morality, you would notice that how there's a growing hostility, even in countries where our religious freedoms and liberties are guaranteed by constitutional rights. Quite often those constitutional rights aren't that strong. Under a constitution guarantee here in Australia, section 116, I just had to think of it, section 116 of the Australian Constitution, we are guaranteed religious freedom. Seventh-day Adventists actually influenced just over 100 years ago for that part to be added into the constitution. However, it's been very narrowly defined in the courts in Australia, where it's your right to come into church and worship, but some of the other rights that we think we can take for granted aren't necessarily guaranteed in the Constitution. But I'll share more about that a little bit later. Now, what is persecution? Persecution can take on many forms. It could be harassment, it could be beatings, it could be kidnappings, rape, forced marriage. You can be chased off your land, forced reconversions, imprisonment, torture, and even murder or martyrdom. And these can have many varied forms. We know that even people who have just shared their worldview, as far as their Christian worldview on ethics and morals are concerned, on social media, doctors in Melbourne have lost their licenses, not able to practice anymore. So this morning we spoke about the freedoms we have in Australia, and we have many freedoms still, but they're systematically being eroded, and things are even changing here in Australia. So what's happening on a daily basis? This is statistics that just were released about a week ago now. So on average, people today, in the next 24 hours, 13 Christians will die for their faith around the world. 12 Christians will be unjustly arrested, detained, and in prison, and some of those will die in prison. 5 Christians will be kidnapped. Persecution of Christians has risen consistently for the last 5 years. And as I said before, it's the highest it's been in modern history. So we operate in 68 countries around the world. We have other sister organizations around the world that we do work with. We don't have the funds to always fund all the projects. We operate probably in around about 22 countries. And we work together through an umbrella organization called the International Christians Association to sometimes help co-fund some of the projects that we work on. But the text that our ministry is based on is found in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 3. And it starts with this very interesting word, remember. It's interesting how God often has to remind us. I don't know about you, but have you learned something in the past as a Christian? only years later to be reminded in a sermon, oh yeah, I forgot about that. We tend to forget as human beings, don't we? This morning, just in the lesson, we were talking about how some people, they have a better memory than others. And sometimes you can fluke it, you know, and sometimes when you're preaching, the Holy Spirit can remind you things you typically won't remember. But our memories are a little bit weak, especially sometimes when it comes to spiritual things. That's why the Bible emphasizes the importance of telling your children when you sit by the, you know, sit down to eat, and when you walk by the wayside, to remind them of what God has done so we don't forget. And we are told in spirit of prophecy there, we've got nothing to fear for the future, except we do what? Forget what the Lord has done in the past and also his past teachings. So this word remember in the King James Bible appears 144 times. New King James is about 165 times. Matter of fact, the fourth commandment starts with the same word, doesn't it? Majority of the Christian world, however, keeps Sunday, not the seventh-day Sabbath. So God wants us to remind us. But the reminder here that our organization is based on is remember the prisoners as if chained with them. Those who are mistreated, since you yourselves are in the body also. Now, what does it mean? Well, I'm in a physical body. If you feel pain, I can sympathize with you because I've stubbed my toe. Or I can sympathize with you because I've cut myself accidentally. It's actually more than that. It's talking about the body of Christ. Christ being the head and we being part of the body and brothers and sisters of one another. Now, can I share that story just to illustrate? What's the smallest member, external member of the human body? Would you say the little toe? It's smaller than the little finger typically, isn't it? Well, my wife goes out to go and sunbathe about a year ago now. She gets a sunbed and I'm busy working inside. She puts her laptop on there. She's going to do some reading or something. And as she goes to get around the pillar, she twists the sunbed and the laptop iPad. Sorry, the iPad falls on with its corner, its edge on her little toe. And I hear her complain. Ow, 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 ow. Anyway, the ow, ow doesn't stop, but keeps on going. And after a couple of minutes, I thought, well, as a good husband, I better go and check what's going on because she's not keeping quiet. And obviously she's in a little bit of pain. I said, what have you done? Oh, no, well, I've had this thing drop on my foot. And anyway, so I said, well, have a look at the thing. It's really swelling up. So I got some ice straight away and iced it a little bit and took the ice away. The pain was still there. And she can't walk now. This is the smallest member of her body, right? But why did her tongue cry out when the tongue was not hurt? Why did her eyes well up with tears when the eyes were not affected? It was only the little toe, the smallest. Why did she walk funny? You know, her foot wasn't affected, her leg wasn't affected, her hip joint wasn't affected. It seems like when one member of the body suffers, that the whole body ends up suffering with it. And this is really what this text is saying here. I can tell you a long story. I actually carried her to the car, being the gentleman that I am. I dragged her across the threshold. I carried her across the threshold. I carried her across the threshold the day we got married. I don't know if you guys still do that. You do that, you know, do the men still do that? You know, you carry your, after you've got married, you say, I do, you've had the ceremony and everything. And then, oh, okay, no one does it. Anyway, I did that. So I carried it to the car. I was not as fit and strong as I was back then. But anyway, this was an emergency and I had to do that. And we got it. And sure enough, little toe was broken, split. The front part of the bone had split. And then there were splinters to the left and to the right of it as well. So she wasn't making it up. So we are to suffer with the body of Christ. When one part suffers, the other is to enter into fellowship through prayer and remembrance and understanding, praying because God does answer prayer. And many people's suffering has been alleviated during persecution, just simply because the church was praying. You know, Peter's in prison. He's going to be executed the next day, but he trusts God so much, he sleeps like a baby. And there's a vigil that's happening during that evening. And Spirit of Prophecy says, if the church hadn't been praying, Peter would not have been released from prison. God answers prayer. So it's important for us to pray for those who are struggling and suffering with persecution. So you'll see there, most of it is through the 1040 window. A lot of it is communism. There's Buddhism. There's Hinduism. There's Islam that has an effect. And there's sometimes in other areas, there's a blend sometimes with Catholicism and paganism, or there's just a blend of some other things. And it gets a little bit complicated if you get to the South America and that part of the world there in North America as well, down the bottom part. So, I want to take you to the country of Romania. Founder Richard Wurmbrand comes from there. He was a secular Jew, a carpenter had prayed that he always wanted to bring a Jew to Christ. And sure enough, Richard Wurmbrand turned out to be this person. He finally actually became a Lutheran pastor. And the Nazis were in Romania for a few years, and then in 1944, as they rolled out, the communists rolled in with a million soldiers. And 3 years later, he was actually arrested on the 29th of February, 1948, and he spent 14 years in a communist prison in Romania, suffering persecution. You can go on the internet and look, they can show the marks and all the things that he did. It's surprising that he survived, but he did survive. He spent 3 years in solitary confinement. Now, some of you who are introverts will go, solitary confinement, no problem. I don't like people anyway, you know. 1 month in solitary confinement would be all good. But even if you're an introvert, God has still made us social creatures. We still need that social interaction. And some people, when they stop the noise, they can't hear anything, no one's talking to them, and then solitary confinement, they go mad. He spent 3 years there. And at times he said, because they were sometimes drugged as well, he said he couldn't even think clearly to pray. And all the words that would come to his mind is, Jesus, I love you. Jesus, I love you. And that would be his prayer. But God knew and God understood. And after that, he wrote a book called Tortured for Christ. Matter of fact, I would give you a copy of this if you haven't read the book already. Today, if you want to sign up to our newsletter, we have a monthly newsletter that comes out, and also prayer points that come out on a weekly basis. Just short little snippets, and if you like them, you can click on them and read and just pray for those people. But this book, Tortured for Christ, he wrote in 1967, it was published, and that's the first time that people realized what was actually happening with the Christians in communist countries. Up to that point, the communists had a facade. They were using a lot of propaganda to tell them that they were Christian friendly. And for those pastors and churches that were willing to compromise, sure, there seemed to be some sort of compromise going on. You know that even in China, there's an official church sponsored by the communists who do not believe in God. It's called the Three Self-Patriotic Movement. They have about 25 million members, but they decide who becomes a pastor and who doesn't, who gets baptized, who doesn't, who can go to seminary and who doesn't. You would have maybe, if you followed the news, the Pope has just recently had an agreement with them, the Vatican, that they will now co-appoint bishops in China, because the Communist Party was doing that. If you toe the line, they'll appoint you, and if you don't, they won't. So you've got to be very careful what you can preach. You cannot preach the resurrection of Christ. You cannot preach the second coming of Christ. There's certain Christian morals that you cannot preach. You can preach that, yeah, God is love, and you can preach to love your neighbor as yourself, but there's a lot of things that you're not entitled to preach. But if you're willing to compromise, you can live in relative peace and harmony with communists who do not believe in God. But anyway, this book I'll make available. If you sign up to our newsletter, what I'm going to do to save time, I'm going to hand out three clipboards, one for each of the areas there. Just hand it around. Use your own pen if you can, be COVID safe. I do have some pens there. So there's three there. So just pass it down. If you want to sign up, just pass it. If you don't want to sign up, just pass it down. And I can collect it at the very end. Then when you leave the church, just let me know. And my wife, Michelle, in the blue, there's with her hand up there, will help me distribute this book, Tortured for Christ. Now, if you're not a reader, maybe you'll say, listen, I maybe watch a program, but I won't read it. Well, we produced what is a Hollywood quality production through our mission in the USA called Tortured for Christ, based on the book. Of course, you can't cram a whole book into a movie, but the movie is available as well if you want to watch it. There's subtitles at times when they do speak in Russian or when they do speak in Romanian. And they even mentioned the Adventists there, because the Adventists were more persecuted than any of the others because they wouldn't work on Sabbath. So the other people lost track of what day it was of the week, except for the Adventists somehow. They always knew when it was Sabbath and they refused to work. And they would know, the rest of the prisoners would know that it was Sabbath or the seventh day, because the Adventists would be beaten that day usually and they could hear them crying. So that's another one. The other one, if you've seen that, you've read it, communism is quite alive and well. This book called Marx and Satan documents the fact that Marx in his high school years was actually a Christian believer. And then something happened in his life and he actually became a Satanist. He wasn't an atheist. So see what motivated him. And if you study the Bible, you'll actually see there that the angel fallen from heaven has the keys to the bottomless pit. And in Revelation chapter 11, the beast that ascends out of the bottomless pit actually makes war with God's two witnesses, which is the word of God. So it was actually a satanic power that was raised up there, but he was a Satanist, and this book is available as well if you want one or the other. You can have one of these. If you've read all three of those, there's one more I'll give you, so I'm going to stop promoting books now after that. But this one I can also give as a gift. It's called Hearts of Fire. It's a story of eight ladies who were persecuted for their faith, including Sabina Wurmbrand, Richard Wurmbrand's wife. So very inspirational. This one a little bit more hard-hitting. Richard Wurmbrand uses quite circumspect language as he describes. You get an idea of what happened to you, but as he described what happened. But these ladies are a little bit more frank in their expressions. Also, if you want to, I do have a few newsletters. This one is from March 2020. There might be one or two. But this is the newsletter you will sign up to if you want it in print. Or if you just want email, just tick the email box. And then I also just brought some of these because communism is not dead. And this is a little tract on that as well, if you're interested in that. So enough of the publicity. Let's get moving. Richard Boombrand, as I said, was arrested off the street, actually kidnapped, and his family didn't know where he was for years, whether he was alive or dead. But he said these thoughts came to him the day that he was arrested on the 29th of February, 1948. Did I believe in God? Now the test had come. I was alone. There were no salaries to earn, no golden opportunities to consider. God offered me only suffering. Would I continue to love him? Would I continue to be faithful? He asked that question. And quite often when we share the teachings of persecution from the Bible, it's very clear there that the prosperity gospel is another gospel. It's a counterfeit gospel where people say, listen, sow your seed into my ministry and God will bless you. The car that you want, the career that you want, the house that you want, all these things God will bless you with. Well, the opposite is actually true for many Christians around the world. The majority of Christians, they do not know whether they will actually continue in their job as a Christian. They do not know whether they will get another meal because they chased off their land as subsistence farmers, or they're not allowed access to the town well to get water, so they've got to drink contaminated water. It's not, the prosperity gospel is another gospel. And as we present these things, quite often people come to realize that. Now, the projects that we work on around the world is Bibles and literature. If we ask persecuted Christians, what are your needs? The first thing you always ask for is prayer. Prayer is so important. They've experienced the power of God answering their prayers in their own life. And they always ask for prayer first. We go, what do we pray for? Do we pray for the persecution to stop? They're going to pray that God will give us strength and boldness to witness for him, even under these circumstances. And also that we may win some of those who are persecuting us. The other one is literature. Then we have frontline ministry, those who actually take Bibles and smuggle Bibles in or bring the gospel to restricted areas. We also support families of martyrs or families of pastors or people who have been thrown into prison and he's the only breadwinner, so we try and provide support for them. We also have VOM Medical. That's our focus this month as well, where people who have been injured through either torture or through some sort of persecution, or perhaps they've just languished in prison and they come out with health issues, we'll help them as well. And then the last one is our general Von Fund ministry. It's the biggest fund, and that's where we all the overflow goes and supports all these other projects if there's not enough money in there. And also that's the fund that I get paid out of. But the top four there, if you give a dollar is used for Bibles or frontline ministry or medical or families of martyrs. So you're 100% guaranteed, although a lot of people seem to support what we do, even with our local ministry here. So when they ask for Bibles, why is the Bible so important? Well, the Word of God tells it very clearly that God's Word is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. Now, why would you need a lamp and a light? Because it's dark out there spiritually. The world is full of darkness, spiritual darkness, and we need God's Word to light our path so we need to know where to walk to follow Christ. Psalm 138 tells us that God has magnified his word above his name. Now, that's a fantastic statement, incredible statement, shows the importance of that. In 1 Peter 1:23, it says, we've been born again, not of corruptible seed, but incorruptible through the word of God, which lives and abides forever. So how are we born again? How do we come into relationship with God? Through his word. And there are many texts there as well. For example, 1 Thessalonians 2:13, for this reason, we also thank God without ceasing. Because when you receive the word of God, which you heard from us, you welcomed it, not as a word of men, but as it is in truth, the word of God, which you also effectively works in you who believe. So the word of God can work in us. And when people get the Bible, what they'll do quite often is they'll break the binding and they'll pull out the pages. And sometimes in the underground church, they'll meet 3 to 4 times a week when it's safe. And they will swap. I've got Matthew 1 and 2. You've got Matthew 3 and 4 and so on. They'll swap and then try and commit to memory. They'll handwrite the Bibles. I've seen handwritten Bibles where they've got a full gospel or gospels written out. And when they have a moment, they eat, breathe, and sleep the word of God. Now, how many Bibles do we have? I thought I might have had 10. I counted the other day. I had over 20 Bibles in our house. Incredible. So we've got full access. And it's almost like the supply and demand scenario plays into this. You know, when there's an abundance of something, it's low value. The price goes down. when there's a shortage and a scarcity, the price goes up. Luckily, they didn't do that for toilet paper during COVID-19 because it ran out for a little while there. But I know the specials disappeared all of a sudden, right? Because they didn't have to special it. So the supply and demand scenario works as well. And then James tells us, of his own will he brought us forth by the word of truth, that he might be a kind of first fruits of his creation. So the word of God is very important, and the persecuted church knows that. If you want to support Bibles and Bibles distribution, here we're distributing Bibles in the jungle because it's illegal in that particular country to distribute Bibles. You're welcome to do that. We also support frontline ministry. I'll just tell you this story very briefly. So this happened on New Year's Day this year, right? So we have a gentleman by the name of Cheng Wenjing, and he's a street preacher. He's just a lay person that preaches, and often the Chinese Communist Party there has actually arrested him, and they have put him in detention for 10 days at a time. The last time it happened was August last year, and since that time they've been released. And we'll just read from the second paragraph there. So despite police repeated arresting and detaining him with these last 10-day detention starting August 3, Cheng continues to proclaim the gospel on the streets of Hangyang. Passionate about spreading the gospel, sometimes alone and sometimes with others, as he regularly preaches on the street through the busy city, he often holds a cross with the inscription, "Glory to God, repent, trust, and be redeemed." So during the pandemic, Cheng continued to preach the gospel. He distributed masks, Bibles, gospel tracts to people on the street. And when police arrested him, he would just smile and just say, "Jesus loves you, God bless you, I will go with you." And when the police officers had released him from detention, he would thank them and bless them. And through the CCP authorities repeatedly warned and threatened that they will arrest and detain him again if he continues to preach on the streets, Cheng does not intend to give up holding his street evangelisms, even if one day he's sentenced to prison. And he is determined to still proclaim the gospel even there. So these are the kind of people that inspire us. You know, was anybody going to threaten us or throw us in prison or detain us for 10 days if we share the gospel in Australia? Not at the moment. That definitely won't happen at this stage. But it could very shortly. So we're told Apostle Paul is writing to young Timothy, and he says the following: "Preach the word, be ready in season and out of season. Convince, rebuke, exhort with all long suffering and teaching. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but according to their own desires, because they have itching ears, they will heap up for themselves teachers, and they will turn their ears away from the truth and be turned aside to fables." So some years we distribute up to 1 million Bibles around the world, depending on funding and how that goes. As I said, we serve in 68 countries around the world. We have completed more than 6,000 projects since we've been around, and this will be the 52nd year that we've been here in Australia. And typically we do 155 projects, sometimes a little bit more depending on funding. Now, sorry, am I speaking a little bit too fast? My wife just told me to slow it down a little bit. Can you all follow my accent okay? Sometimes when I feel I've got a lot to say, I speed it up a bit, or if I get excited, I'm okay, or should I slow it down? Okay. The other thing is also, I was just talking to Brother Tony here and asking him if we're a midday church, and he said, "Don't worry about it." So I don't know if that means a 1 p.m. church, or I'm not sure. But what I'm going to guarantee for you, if I see like maybe 3% of the 3% of the audience looking a little bit dopey, I will stop. But if you look like you're paying attention, I'll just preach a little bit longer. Anyway, I'm going to speed this up a little bit, so I don't want to hold you too longer, so don't be too worried. I'll tell you some of the stories from Pakistan. So we've got our medical fund that we support people. This story here comes from Pakistan. So the court acquitted a Christian sentenced to blasphemy in Pakistan. Now, they've got blasphemy laws there, which is very difficult for Christians. For example, if someone even asks you on public transport, what's your religion, you say you're a Christian, and they say, "Well, why aren't you a Muslim?" Even in the way you answer that question, it could be considered blasphemy. So you've got to be very careful. So a Christian man was sentenced to death and has been acquitted by the Pakistani court 6 years after he was charged with blaspheming the Islamic prophet Muhammad. The Lahore High Court acquitted Sawan Masa, a street sweeper from eastern city of Lahore. Now, a lot of Christians in Pakistan are finding it difficult to get the high-paying jobs. They normally get the menial jobs and nobody else wants to, simply because they are boycotted in regards to their career opportunities and that. So he's a street sweeper. He's the father of three, accused by a Muslim friend of insulting the Islamic prophet. And during the conversation in the eastern city of Lahore, now he denies these charges. The accusations were made, according to him, because of a property dispute. But now the following day, after this argument between him and his friend, the mosque recounted the accusations against Musa over their PA system. Now, I don't know if you've been in an Islamic country. 5 a.m. in the morning, they have a call to prayer. They've got these horns everywhere. You can hear them. That happens 5 times a day. Even when we were in Bethlehem, remember they had this call to prayer while we were there, and there were a number of mosques doing it all at the same time. Anyway, so they now publish what has happened with this argument, and this prompted a mob of 3,000 Muslims to loot and burn 180 Christian homes. So they didn't even have anything to do with this argument. 75 Christian shops and at least 2 churches were damaged in their response. Now, families were forced to flee the area. Musa was handed over to the police. He was charged under Section 295 of the Pakistani Penal Code. In October last year, the Lahore High Court decided that the prosecution had failed to establish that Musa had committed blasphemy, although he'd been in prison for 6 years. They acquitted him, reversing the sentence. Well, the backlash was quite bad. His family had to go into hiding, and he's also in hiding at the moment as well. Some of you may have remembered in the last couple of years, a lady called Azia Bibi, who had been on death row under blasphemy laws for 10 years. She was released, and then her family had to go into hiding. And finally, they had to actually smuggle her out of the country. She's now living in Canada. A matter of fact, if COVID allows us, she'll be out later in the year, and she'll be sharing her testimony of her experiences. So there's another story, also from Pakistan. Pakistan prosecutes anyone who seems or is seen to be insulting Islam with the result of penalty of imprisonment or death. And it is claimed that the judges in the smaller Pakistani courts are too afraid to let Christians go free in those cases due to the threats to themselves. And they don't have the same security detail that the people in the Supreme Court or the High Court has. Now, according to Sanjeet, who's the Human Friends Organization worker, he says the judges in the low courts do not have the same security as the high courts, so they don't take the bold decisions. The Supreme Court can make daring decisions like the acquittal of Azia Bibi because they have high-level security. Now, this Christian man in the photo, Asif Pervez, was sentenced to death on the 8th of September last year after he allegedly sent blasphemous texts to a work colleague back in 2013. Pervez says his SIM card and that was stolen and the messages were forged. And the issue with this was actually that he refused to convert to Islam. So this was an attack on him. Now, Asif has spent the last 7 years in prison. He will be executed by hanging after completing another 3 years. So this is someone that needs prayer from us. Now, Sanjeet Paul says the reason for the case like this is the intolerance about coexistence between Christians in Pakistan and also Islam, which is the dominant religion there. He says, I've never seen a Christian commit blasphemy. They are always falsely accused. And his analysis of the data shows that in the past 30 years, there's been a Christian victim of these blasphemy laws in Pakistan every 6 weeks. Jesus said in John chapter 16, verse 33, I've said these things to you that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but take heart, or as the King James say, be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Stories from Indonesia, just very quickly. In 2018, there was a bomb blast at 2 or 3 different churches. Around May 13th, this happened. A family split up onto 3 different motorbikes. 2 sons went one way. A mum and her 2 daughters with a 9-year-old went another way, and the father went another way. And as people were coming out of the church, they blew themselves up. The daughters, the 9-year-old daughter, the youngest daughter there, was just used as like a, I don't know if you call it a smokescreen or whatever it is, because people wouldn't suspect that you would want to kill your own children in the process. But there were quite a number, 28 people that were killed, and there were more than 50 people injured. Now, this lady here, Fenny, was injured as she came out of church. You can see the scar tissue on her arm here from all the burning from the blast. And you can also see just there, because the scar tissue is so strong, when she has to move her arm, it will actually tear there. There's no mobility. So we've actually paid for treatments to get her to get her mobility back, because if you can't really move her arm, she's going to struggle to work. Also, her daughter, Clarissa, unfortunately, was injured in the little blast as well at that time. So VOM Medical stepped in Indonesia and helped for these people just to get their lives back in order again. Pastor Jumbo, also from Indonesia, he's been preaching the gospel there for many years. He's been threatened many times by sharing the gospel. And one night, coming back from a Christian program at church, he's on his motorbike. And in those areas, they don't wear helmets. And you can see some movement just in the lights, or just on the side of the lights, street lights, as he's going down. As he gets closer, 2 men step out and they swing at him with a machete to decapitate him. He ducks, gets hit in the face, knocks him off the motorbike, and he falls badly. But as he gets up to run away and call for help, he realizes he can't cry out. They had actually beaten his, instead of hitting his neck, it hit him in the mouth. And you can see there the line. So we actually paid for the reconstructive surgery and that. He now still preaches the gospel, says he's got the widest smile in the world for Christ. But what a brave man, what a person that's bold for the Lord. These are stories that happen on a regular basis around the world. Romans 12:12 tells us, be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. So I've covered all that. I don't think we need to go through that again. A story from China. This pastor, which is the Early Rain Covenant Church, has been shut down totally by the CCP there. He's been in prison for 9 years now. His wife is under basically house arrest. She cannot move anywhere with them following her movements. And also, she's not allowed to see the family. A son, which still stays with her, which they used to house school, they can no longer house school. So what happens is the son, Joshua, is forced daily to ride with the police to the Chinese Communist Party public school, where he's indoctrinated in regards to the teachings of the Chinese Communist Party. Now, I mentioned this very briefly. It says, when they, that's God's two witnesses, the Old and New Testament, finish their testimony, the beast that ascends out of the bottomless pit, by the way, it's the angel of the bottomless pit, the angel fallen from heaven that has the keys, will make war against them, overcome them, and kill them. So here is a power, a satanic power, controlled. We believe this refers to the French Revolution, but atheism and all the isms, communism and everything that grew out of that is part of this. They will make war against God's word. And this is something that was released in the textbook just very recently in China. It says, the story of a woman caught in adultery as told in the Gospel of John is a powerful story of mercy, forgiveness, and divine authority. But in the official textbook, the Chinese Professional Ethics and Law textbook, the Chinese Communist Party has used the story as an illustration, but the plot has been heavily altered to better adapt to the CCP's philosophy. So in the textbook, the modified passage now reads, the crowd wanted to stone the woman to death as per their law. But Jesus said, let the one who has never sinned throw the first stone. Hearing this, they slipped away one by one. When the crowd disappeared, Jesus stoned the sinner to death, saying, I too am a sinner. But if the law could only be executed by men without blemish, the law would be dead. So this malicious distortion seriously distorts and defiles the image of Christ in Christianity. The textbook infers that if only people without sin can enforce the law, then the law would become powerless. It implies that because illegal behaviors of Chinese judicial officials in law enforcement are unavoidable, they should be tolerated. So Christians in China have been protesting against this textbook. But isn't that a war against God's word? The war is actually worse than that. You know that the China has got the biggest printing press of Bibles in the world. It's called Amity Press. They print a quarter of the world's Bibles. You can put in an order for 10,000 Bibles. You can get good quality. You can get cheap, whatever you want, and they'll print it for you. But it's very, very difficult for Chinese Christians, especially in the underground church, to get their hands on the Bible. So if you belong to an official church, you may be able to get a Bible, but you can't buy a Bible in a bookshop. You cannot buy a Bible online since January 2018. All Bible apps are banned as well, unless you can get onto a VPN to try and download a Bible. So it's very difficult. And what Christians in the underground church would normally do is go to a underground church, but that's become impossible now as well because of the hoops they've got to jump through to get it done. Right, going to India very quickly. So 15 Christian families were left homeless after an attack upon them. I'm just going to see if I can move this so I can read a little bit better. Okay, so 15 Christian families from three villages in India's Chhattisgarh state were left homeless after being attacked by religious fanatics. Local Christians claim the attack took place after families refused to recant their Christian faith. Now, in late 2020, members of the Hindu nationalist group summoned 15 Christian families to a meeting. There, the Christians were told they had to recant their faith or they would be forced to leave their village. When the Christians refused the Hindu members' attack, the Christians were beaten and forced to sign an affidavit which stated that they agreed to stop receiving government subsidies and support, including basic food assistance that is normally distributed on a monthly basis. After the meeting, the members attacked and demolished the homes of the Christians who refused to recant their faith. And following the destruction of the homes of Christians, families have fled into the jungle for safety. And many further attacks, fearing many further attacks, and most are not confident that they will receive any form of justice. Okay, so these are three young people who were banished from a village as well. I won't go through that story. But this is what's happened from January the 3rd so far in India. There's quite a number of stories. One, Pastor David was charged for engaging in religious conversion activities. There's about 9 states now where they have anti-conversion laws, and they refer to it as forced conversions. Now, I don't know of any Christian group that forces anybody or bribes anybody to become a Christian. I know that they are forced to convert back to Hinduism. This one here, January 7th, Christian families were given an ultimatum: give up your faith or you're banished from the village. Imagine you live in a village all your life and all of a sudden you can't come back now. The pastor's already been banned from going to the village and preaching and sharing the word there with them. Also on the same day, the Christian couple were at a house invasion. They were dragged out of the house and repeatedly attacked. January 8th, the anti-Christian rally was held, and one of the chants was Christians should be chased away from India. This one is probably a little bit more positive because there are some good people, even if they have a different worldview. And we see that around the world from time to time, where even, you know, the law, God says, those who do not know the law, but by nature do the things contained in the law, they are a law to themselves. Their conscience either accusing or excusing them. You read that in Romans chapter 2. But Pastor Andrzej Pal conducted a prayer meeting, they were arrested for religious conversion activities. Again, this is always the accusation, religious conversion activities. The Christian leaders went to the police station and said the accusations were false. And fortunately, the pastor there was released, but they prayerfully did this. It's very important that we just go in our own strength. January 10, also Christians were chased and threatened when coming to attend a prayer meeting. Pastor Mangal went and laid a formal complaint to the police there, but it was ignored in this instance. And then Pastor Sable was threatened at the market while trying to sell saris. Now, he's a bivocational pastor, so he actually supports himself. That's how he makes a livelihood. And because I knew he was a Christian, they said to him that he was converting people through inducements. Now, he's not a very wealthy guy, so I don't know what inducements they were suggesting he was using. But they demanded to leave him to leave the market. He was threatened. The police intervened, and they finally believed the pastor, and the pastor was released, and they told the group also that he had the right to go and sell his wares at that market. Christian woman was savagely beaten by a couple for her religious beliefs after they broke into her house. She needed 12 stitches to the wound in her head, and there were many other bodily bruising and that from it. So this happens around the world. There was a baptismal meeting, 25 to 30 people at this meeting. They were singing hymns when a group surrounded the building where they're at. They accused them of a religious conversion meeting in progress. Now, typically the conversion has happened when people are there for baptism, but no one was coerced. When the police arrived, they took 12 people into custody and charged them under section 118 of the India Penal Code. 188, sorry. So Jesus said in a Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 5, 6 and 7, Jesus hardly hits verse 10 when he already starts talking about persecution. I think around verse 43, he talks about persecution again. When you become aware of persecution, it's amazing how much the Bible has to say about it and the advice given to us and what we are to expect as Christians. But blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they when they revile and persecute you and say all kinds of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven, for so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. In Nepal, this woman was actually stoned, almost left for dead. She was in hospital for a week. But if you look at the very end there, Mary was taken to hospital, suffering from deep gashes to her face and neck, along with internal bleeding. She still finds it difficult to speak. She wants to forgive her neighbor, who she believes will come to know Jesus one day. A different attitude. I don't get upset when people cut us off in the traffic. But these people show us what Christianity is really like. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. In Tanzania, this man he can't find work at the moment. You know, we read about a no buy, no sell, no trade coming in the future if you don't receive the mark of the beast. Well, there's some people who cannot buy or sell at the moment because no one will give them the job simply because they're a Christian. In Egypt, this guy, he was actually captured by his family and tortured for 4 months. He finally escaped. They took 2 of his daughters away, so him and his wife finally fled. Jesus says in John 16, verse 2 and 3, so this is by a religious group, right? But we also know that this even happens within Christianity. History teaches us that very clearly through the Dark Ages. It says they will put you out of the synagogue. In fact, the time is coming when anyone who kills you will think they are offering a service to God. They will do such things because they have not known the Father nor me. That word known is very interesting in the Greek, gnosko. It's intimately knowing God. Nigeria, Boko Haram has killed so many people. There's been 50,000 or more people killed since 2009. Matthew, when they persecute you in this city, flee to another. For assuredly, I say to you, they will not have gone. You would not have gone through the cities of Israel before the Son of Man comes. In Uganda, this guy who was a former imam became a Christian. What happened to another lady who didn't like him? Actually, apparently abducted his children, 11-year-old and 13-year-old. The 13-year-old was made the wife of this witch doctor. The 11-year-old, they allege, he's just disappeared. He may have been used for as a human sacrifice. There are many stories like that. This one I will read to you. I have a love for radio and do share on radio quite a bit in different radio stations around Australia. But David Omara was the pastor of a Christian church center, a well-known radio preacher in northern Uganda. During a recent radio broadcast, he contrasted Christianity to Islam. After finishing the broadcast, Pastor David received a phone call from a listener who expressed appreciation for his message and invited him to meet with some friends. Unaware of the danger that awaited him, Pastor David went to the meeting with his son, Simon. Upon arrival, the two men were ambushed by six people. Simon managed to escape, but Pastor David was strangled and beaten to death. When his wife received the shattering news, she immediately passed out and even after receiving treatment was unable to recognize people. Speaking of the incident, a colleague said that the same pastor, he worked tirelessly for the kingdom of God to the day he breathed his last breath. The pastor survived by his wife and their eight children who ranged between the ages of 10 to 30. Despite having a reputation for being one of the most Christian nations in Africa, a strong militant Islamic stance has created problems in recent years. God will wipe every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things would have passed away. Then he who sat on the throne said, "Behold, I make all things new." And he said to me, "Write these things, for these words are true and faithful." So there are five persecution zones around the world. You've got secularism, communism, Islam, Hinduism, Buddhism. And then there's also special zones, which are in the black. But the blue zones is where we live. It's called atheism. And atheism has crept in. And another presentation, I might have shared with you the stats from the census data in Australia. But in the most recent census, in 5 years, 8% of the population no longer identifies Christian. We went from 60% to 52%. Matter of fact, the most recent poll by McCringle says that we are now at around about 47 or 48% of people identifying. So where do we lose 8% of the population leaving Christianity and going to atheism? Because atheism went from 22% to 30% in the same period in 5 years. Did you know that the first loss of 8% from the 1901 census in Australia to 1966 took 65 years? We're now losing them in 5 years, 8%. Anyway, the world is rapidly changing, and we see more hostility growing towards Christians around the world. Now, have you heard of this Chains of Suppression Conversion Practice Prohibition Bill? Some of you are from Victoria. This is where this bill has now passed the lower house. I think it was the 10th or the 12th of December. 10th of December it was passed. They've not modified it at all, but basically what it will do, it will make it a criminal offense for Christians to pray for people who are struggling with their sexual identity or their sexual desires. And even if a request is made by the person, maybe they're in a sermon and say to the pastor, "Please, can you pray with me? I'm struggling with these things." That would also be illegal. So let me see how much time. Okay, we'll wrap this up. 13-year-old Susie, this is a scenario. I just want to give you the scenario so you know how the law could be applied. 13-year-old Susie Smith is uncomfortable with her female birth sex and is beginning to realize that she really is a boy. She has shared this concern with a teacher at school and has received encouragement to consider a gender transition. Susie's parents, Bob and Jenny, feel that Susie might be experiencing a period of gender dysphoria and unhappiness that will soon pass with a little bit of help. However, Bob and Jenny are prohibited under the new law from discussing this with Susie unless their conversation is directly related to affirming Susie's desires and change. Bob and Jenny are not allowed to get assistance from their doctor, pastor, or friends. Even if Susie would like help from mum and dad to remain a girl, Bob and Jenny would still be investigated and prosecuted if they advised her against the change. So Susie has some serious emotional and mental issues. Bob and Jenny would like to take Susie to a psychiatrist interstate, but even then the new law will catch up with them because even interstate help is prohibited if it affects someone in Victoria. So back at school, teachers and the school doctor are fully protected by the new law if they support an affirmation of Susie's gender change. And even if that should lead to a dangerous puberty, blocking drugs and breast removal, that's fine. The law supports them. The proposed law also provides for Bob and Jenny to be re-educated. We've seen this even in the US with people who have denied the right of, to not bake cakes for, say, same-sex marriage, which they personally didn't agree with. And then they had to be re-educated, their staff had to be re-educated, or they didn't want to rent out their facilities. And for Susie to be given access to support agencies. So the world is changing, and this is here in Australia. And you could be a criminal just here because you prayed to someone on the phone in Victoria because they asked for you to pray with them. Okay, so what are the penalties? Injury. If there's injury, it's 5 years in jail, up to 5 years in jail, or $100,000 fine. If there's a serious injury, penalties up to 10 years in jail and up to $200,000 in fine, just for praying with someone or just for sharing a Bible text with someone because you want to and they want help, even if they solicited this. So injury under the section 4 of this this bill is the same meaning as the Crimes Act injury, which includes temporary injury and includes harm to mental health. So if you've made them a little bit more depressed or something like that, that could be considered injurious. Richard Wurmbrand said the following: whoever has known the spiritual beauty of the underground church cannot be satisfied anymore with the emptiness in some Western churches. I suffer in the West more than I suffered in communist jail because now I see in my own eyes Western civilization dying. And anybody that wants to argue with the stats, Western civilization is dying. Christianity is dying. We are hemorrhaging Christians. We lost 8% here in Australia in 5 years. The US, exactly the same. We went from 70-something percent to whatever it was, but they lost 8% in 5 years as well. Atheism and secularism is eroding the Christian fabric of society. And why is that? Well, we've gone from the silent majority in Australia to the silent minority because we have not been a witness for Christ. Now, Jesus says, you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and the ends of the earth. Well, we have not been witnesses. The word witness there, by the word, is martus in the Greek. It doesn't mean a death cult. It actually means to be a witness. But, of course, some people will witness for Christ with their lives. We won't go through that. If you want to pledge to support a frontline worker, you're welcome to do that. These people in Vietnam are working in the underground church. They baptized 360 people and planted 4 churches last year. This pastor, he had more than 500 people accept Christ and 300 were baptized. 12 churches were planted. And basically, you know, a lot of people have a cup of coffee for about $5. You can either support a frontline worker for $1 a day, that's $30 a week. You can help support. If you're interested, please see us. And remember, Jesus said in Matthew 25, then the king will say to those on his right hand, come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. I was hungry, you gave me food. I was thirsty, you gave me drink. I was a stranger, you took me in. Naked, you clothed me. Sick, you visited. In prison, and you came to me. So, dear friends, thank you for the opportunity to share with you. There's hours and hours of material. It's much shorter if you just sign up to the newsletter and just read the small snippets and you just pray for that. Remember, if you sign up, see us at the back, we will hand you a gift. And you can reach us on the following, or you can commit to pray, you can go to that website, or you can even send us an email. Now, do we close with a song or do I close with a prayer now? Okay, we'll close with a song and then I have last prayer. Let me just stop sharing my screen. But thank you so much for the opportunity of sharing you. God bless you. And may God guide and lead you in your decisions of how you want to engage with the underground church and enter into fellowship with them.
Faith and duty, beautiful words, wonderful words. Blessed One gives to all wonderful words of life. Sinnerless to the loving call, wonderful words of life. Also freely given, wooing us to heaven. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Words of life and beauty, teach me faith and duty. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life.
Let's bow our heads for prayer. Our gracious Father in heaven, we give you all the praise and all the glory, for you are our creator. Father, you also the one that called prophets into existence to give us your word. Beautiful words, wonderful words of life. Father, we know they are the life blood of the church. The underground church, the persecuted church around the world, where millions of our fellow believers are suffering because of their fidelity and faithfulness to you. Father, we can see things changing in Australia, storm clouds forming on the horizon. And we know the end will come at some stage, and we know that it could be very close as we look at the things around us. We see the times and the seasons, and you tell us to be watching and to be ready. And Father, we just pray that every person's heart here would be recommitted and rededicated to you. There's so many things that distract us in the West. We've got it so easy here. We just pray, Father, for faithfulness in the small things, so when the big tests do come, that we will remain faithful. We know this will be over one day soon, Father. We know that this whole system and order of things will be gone, and the new order of the everlasting kingdom of Christ will be ushered in, where we'll spend 1,000 years with you in heaven, and then ultimately on the new earth, where no more sickness, no more sorrow, no more persecution, no more pain. The former things will be forgotten, and we will be able to spend eternity with you in that eternal bliss of joy, of intimacy with our Creator face to face. Dismiss us now with your blessing, we pray, and we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Brother Ettienne. God bless. Can we say an amen? Could we get a good amen?
Amen?
Thank you very much. I did not know that was happening, Brother Ettienne. Thank you very much. So remember to pray for the folk who are in on the persecution. If you filled out a form, I suppose we'll collect it at the back. And yes, until then, God bless you. We'll see you next week. We start at 9:30. There is a sanitizer, hand sanitizer. So please make use of the hand sanitizer as you're on your way out. And Brother Ettienne will greet you. God bless you. Thank you very much. Until next week. Bye-bye.
Creatures of our God and King, lift up your voice and with us sing. Alleluia, 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 alleluia.
Thou flowing pure and clear, make music for thy Lord to hear. Alleluia, alleluia. Thou fire so masterful and bright,